are listening to OffPlanet Radio at offplanetradio.com.
Welcome to OffPlanet TV, OffPlanet Radio. I'm Randy Maugans. The websites are offplanetradio.com and offplanetmedia.net. And on this show tonight, we are going to go through the evidence of UFO activity, not just here in the United States, but around the world and apparently as well off-planet. Wow, we finally get some off-planet photography. This is awesome. And I have with me my co-host Chris Holly.
Hello, everybody.
And our guest for this episode is New Jersey MUFON Star Team Investigator. He has been on the show several times before, but not for a very, very long time. And we welcome him back to the program. Ken Pfeifer, welcome.
Hi, Randy. Hi, Chris. How you doing?
We're doing great.
Good to see you. I hear from you again, Ken. Can't wait to hear what you got to tell us this time.
Yeah, I have some good stuff.
Well, you know, it's been a long time since we've done anything like this. We actually did this back on the old radio show, and that was kind of fun. We did the slide thing, and what we're doing is we're kind of doing a pre-record for the TV show tonight, which means that your slides are going to be going out as we do the commentary tonight. We've got 10 slides that you've sent us, and what we're going to do is kind of go through the narrative. But before we start tonight, Ken, update us a little bit on your own activities, what you've been doing, what's going on with New Jersey MUFON, the STAR team, and UFOlogy in general.
Well, I've been pretty busy with my websites. Of course, my worldufophotos.org, I have close to 9,000 UFO photos, Mars images. I have a strange photos, a ton of everything, and that kind of keeps me pretty busy. And of course, I have my World UFO Photos and News.org news website that I update every day. I usually take one of the best articles I can find, or a lot of time people send me these articles and send me their encounters, so I type them up and publish them. So that's been kind of keeping me busy here lately, but it's exciting. It really is.
Well, you know, I get your emails every day, and we actually post a feed onto the website as well at OffPlanet. Is it on offplanetmedia.net? It's probably on the blog. I constantly see your material streaming through, and you are what I call regular because you're posting information daily. The amount of photographic evidence that we have obtained over the years is staggering. And you don't back away from the fact that you believe these are alien craft. You're always very bold about that. Many UFOlogists kind of hedge their bets in terms of what they're seeing. And yet at the same time, I notice you will make the distinction between what you suspect are alien craft or what may be our own advanced project type craft. Generally, what we see now, or is it clear? Is it getting clearer now of what we're seeing that might be off-world or versus the military's own projects?
Well, we've been getting more and more photos that definitely look like alien craft. I'm about the only one who says that. Everyone else is afraid to say alien craft. Everyone says UFO. And you know, and I know, when someone says UFO, they usually mean alien craft.
Right.
So MUFON, As a matter of fact, on MUFON's show on TV, Hangar One, which is a really, it is a great show. They're starting to come around and they're starting to say alien, which I'm kind of glad. You know, let's call it what it is. That's my way of thinking.
Well, and that's what I meant when I said that, you know, I felt you were being bold because, while, you know, I do see MUFON investigators out there that are, you know, John Venture here in Pennsylvania, he's been pretty good about recognizing the fact that a lot of what we're seeing is off-world, and other MUFON. But MUFON in general, as an institution, as an organization, has been neutral at best on this. And a lot of times, you know, some of the investigators tend to almost go to the side of debunkers. But the evidence of stuff in the sky is beyond any doubt at this point. I would say that you're criminally insane if you think that you can ignore the evidence that's been amassed, even with your two websites. Tell people about your websites, Ken, where you're putting all this information up.
Well, essentially, I get this information from all over the world. I have a couple dozen UFO organizations that I work with that sends me their photos. They send me the articles, and we kind of swap articles and photos, and we're all kind of working together. And I try to take the best of what's was published that day and put it, you know, add it to my website, worldufophotosandnews.org. I'm getting, I guess right now, I probably got about 1,500 case files, articles on my website, and it seems that we're getting more and more evidence that these things are real, and even just the military case files alone are just incredible. Even, you know, the astronauts, we have public officials, we have presidents that have come out and said they've seen UFOs, you know, it's incredible that people are starting to admit that these things exist.
Ken, can I get a question in here? Ken,
yes.
Do you feel that the amount of reports, the actual number of reports over the last, let's say, 5 years, stay about the same? Are they less? Are they much more? Or is it stay kind of standard? What's your feeling on that?
Well, I think we're getting more reports. We're getting more people who are starting to hear about MUFON and UFOs, and you know, they see it on TV shows and movies, on the news every once in a while about something strange in the sky. I think just more people are just being aware to look up into the sky, and some of them are starting to change their views about, you know, that these things exist, these flying saucers and aliens, and these things are here, and you know, we just have to deal with it.
Yeah, is it any regional? Are there more certain areas, let's say in the United States, that seem to have more sightings than others, or more activity than other areas?
Well, yeah, there are more states. I would say California would be a very very busy state. They get many, many reports. But then again, California is a big state, you know.
Right.
And you know, my theory about all this is UFOs are very curious. They're curious about military bases. They're curious about fireworks. You know, they love airports, nuclear plants. You know, anything that's out of the normal, this is what they tend to investigate themselves. You know, if you're flying around up in your flying saucer in the upper atmosphere and you see these strange lights down below, you know, of course you're going to investigate them. And we get tons of sightings during the 4th of July. You know, and of course the debunkers and the skeptics, they say, you know, they write it off right away as fireworks, and that's crazy. You know, these flying saucers, they hang around even after these fireworks displays are over, and these things are spotted every 4th of July. I think they're just curious.
That's interesting. Or they just zoomed in for the display because they like a damn good fireworks.
They like
display.
A good party.
Yep, they do.
Yeah, they're checking. they probably have the best view, sitting there in their flying saucer, I guess. I don't know.
Well, given that they probably gave up explosives several thousand generations ago, I'm guessing that this is kind of a curiosity, like being able to go in and peek at a less evolved civilization.
Like us watching the Egyptians.
Yeah, like watching the Egyptians.
Yeah, exactly.
Watching the Egyptians build the pyramids. That would be they were probably there too, checking them out.
If not building it for them.
Yeah, that's true.
And can I just ask Randy one more question? And I think my questions are quite. My other question to Ken, I'm just curious because there's so many of them in my area, and I don't even know, you know, Randy, if I asked if they were as many in yours of these orbs, the new, I call them the new, you know, the 2015, since like 2012, the new style unidentified object in the sky are these orbs, these bright colored, usually, you know, red or orange, white, the typical blue, neon blue, orbs that are seen all over. Is that more common or taking the place of or just added to what's being seen?
I don't think they're more common. They're not unknown here, and we've seen a few of those. What is going on with the orbs is interesting because it's now a phenomena that's getting documented much more consistently. I just saw a video on Facebook yesterday of somebody who filmed these. They're now calling them globes. I'm not sure if that's just a new name, but they're calling them globes now. These were huge, and they were filmed from an airplane that was circling to go in for a landing in Atlanta.
Wow.
You know, I have to try and dredge that video up again because I may want to drop that in at some point. But we've seen them. They're not as common. Pennsylvania goes hot and cold. Now, I notice New Jersey, Ken, and New York are trending much higher right now than Pennsylvania in terms of overall UFO sightings. Pennsylvania seems to have gone through flaps. We had heavy flaps in the 60s and the 70s. And then they'll die down for a while. But there are reports. I see the reports that come through. There's a couple of websites that I monitor that have reports that go up. And I can't think of the one website I was just looking at. But it looks like New Jersey and New York are really still pretty consistent activity. There's 10 or more sightings a month that are reported, which, you know, what's reported is a percentage of what probably people are seeing.
Yeah. I guess the average is about three. We get about two or three a week, two a week. Thank God I got a couple more investigators to help me out. I got a couple gung-ho guys who are really there to help me out, and they're doing a great job, and they're investigating the way, you know, I like them to investigate. There's so many investigators from MUFON who are basically, they guessed that a witness saw a drone or a witness saw a satellite, and all they're doing is guessing, and they're writing a lot of case files off as identified flying objects, satellites or drones or whatever, and it's you can't investigate that way.
No, not good. I think that possibly, which I have a good question for you too, Randy, is I think that New Jersey and New York, especially where I am, because I'm stuck out in the middle of the ocean on an island. But I think the ocean, the Atlantic Ocean, it has something to do with our seeing or spotting a lot of things that we don't know what they are, because I would imagine that they either land in or use or are coming out of the ocean and going, you know, other places, and they fly over us. But Pennsylvania, isn't that, Randy, the area where they have the silence area where they are? Do you know what I'm talking about? Where there's no radio or television or cell phones?
I know what you're talking about. That's actually, I think that's in West Virginia.
Oh, it's not. I thought it was one in Pennsylvania.
Yeah.
And I was wondering what kind of activity they had, if they would honestly tell us, being that they are doing such a strange thing that these people that would have the technology to pick up immediately, that we made that a quiet area, you know, a silent area. I can't remember the term they use for it, but it's closed off to everything else. And I always felt that they must be connected to the UFO phenomenon, because it's just a strange thing for us to do.
That particular area you're talking about, I know what you're talking about, and I don't have the name for it right now, that's a radio telescope.
Of course.
That's situated there. Much like the one, by the way, down in New Mexico at Mount Graham, which is not only just a radio telescope, but it is a radar telescope. And they tend to operate, they need to operate in places that are free of normal radio, microwave, and EMF signals.
I think that's the largest in the world, the one down in Puerto Rico. I'd love to go down there and just see that.
Well, you literally can't get to the one on Mount Graham. They'll shoot you before they let you go up to Mount Graham. That's the Vatican Observatory, and from what I understand, nobody gets up there unless you've had a personal invitation.
Oh, yeah. You know, I'm sure you're right.
I would love to know what they actually pick up or what actually flies over them. I think it would be very fascinating.
Well, the word is, this comes from author Tom Horn, who's been up there. He's a well-known paranormal investigator. And Horn says that the Vatican Observatory director has stated that sometimes they wish the UFOs would get out of the way of the telescope because they're trying to find astronomical data.
Oh, God.
Isn't that wild?
Yeah. Yes.
This is the Vatican. By the way, that telescope is called the Lucifer. Isn't that interesting? The Vatican has a telescope called the Lucifer.
That's really strange.
Yeah, it's really odd. I think they're looking for something.
That's disturbing. That's what that is.
Really disturbing. But I think they may be looking for Planet X is what I think they're looking for.
I didn't know that that was the name of it. And I honestly find that disturbing, kind of like crazy, and makes me really wonder what they're doing up there. Yeah. You know, you just don't know. Ken, what's the strangest thing that you've been told or saw or whatever in like the summer so far?
This summer, I've been pretty, we've got a few cases in. We have a couple of abduction cases that just recently came in from New Jersey, but I try not to talk about them cases until they've been fairly investigated and I have permission from the witness, so I can tell their story. So, now, I got a couple things right now that I'm working on investigating, and once I finalize it, you'll be the first one to say it.
Well, that's interesting.
Yeah, other than that, you know, it's just a typical UFOs flying over. A lot of them seem to be down towards the McGuire Air Force Base area, the shore area, and of course. All the towns there, Staten Island, Hoboken, all the towns across from Manhattan, we usually get a slew of UFO reports from there because, you know, at nighttime, I think, if these aliens are flying around in their craft in the upper atmosphere, at nighttime, Manhattan stands out like a diamond. So I think they come down to investigate and a lot of these, that's why we get a lot of sightings from that area.
That's true. And as I say, they fly over along, it's usually the South Shore coast, which faces the Atlantic Ocean of Long Island all the time. All the time. Every week, somebody sees them. It is not a week that goes by that I don't get a couple of emails or I'm left messages on my Skype or I'm told by people I know, they're all seeing those orb things over at Kismet again or something, which is a beach on the ocean. And it's getting sort of like accepted, which bothers me because on one hand, they don't want to, everybody, the society doesn't want to hear it and laughs it off. And then we have pockets like Long Island where it's becoming like accepted. Oh, yeah, like those bothersome orbs always flying around. And I'm saying to myself, wait a minute, isn't anyone here upset to the point where they say, yeah, well, it's in the sky, it's over my house, it's over my family, I want to know what they are. My confusion is why the public doesn't deal with it differently. It's now all the time, seen all the time. And I don't understand it. I don't understand their reaction.
Well, I think it's just being ignored. As a matter of fact, I think a lot of the news agencies have probably been contacted by the government to downplay, you know, UFO sightings, because there's a ton of them out there, and you would think that these things would be newsworthy, but every once in a while you see something on TV, but I think these news agencies have been given the word and from the government. That's the only theory I can think of.
Well, overall, right now, are we in kind of a quiet period? Are we normal activity? What do you see in terms of statistics of sightings and other types of activity that get mapped by you and MUFON?
Well, I think we're starting to see more activity. Everyone has a cell phone now, and everyone has carrying around a camera in their hand. Everyone. And like I said, there's more people that's being aware, that's starting to get into the UFO phenomenon. They're starting to hear about MUFON and people like yourself. I think we're just starting to get more reports. Not that there haven't been many sightings out there, that I think a lot of people either in the past may have ignored it, or a lot of them were really, believe it or not, they don't know who to call. Everyone assumes that, everyone knows MUFON, but if you were to go out in the street and interview 99 out of 100 people, they wouldn't know what MUFON was.
That's one of the tragedies of the years spent, that we don't have higher profile investigation in recognition of investigation, I guess, is what I want to say, is that despite the fact that MUFON has, raised its profile somewhat with the recent TV series, it really has not put itself out there in that way. It's kind of been shuttered off to the side. And I think, the other part of it is most people, if they're aware that something's strange or different, tend to call police, which really, quite frankly, they don't know what to do with it. They're probably secretly trained to ignore most of this or to dismiss it as, some sort of weird phenomena. People still look to law enforcement to investigate something that law enforcement doesn't understand and isn't trained to deal with, which is, weird.
That's right. Yeah, you go down and talk to your local police chief down there and ask him, what do you guys do if somebody reports a UFO? Is there a number that you tell them to call, or what do you do? And a lot of times you can just get a blank stare, like, what are you talking about? It's really strange.
I want to ask you both a question because you brought it up, Ken, before when you said you have some investigations you're working on, but you don't have the permission or the material given to you yet or released to display. I had a situation here, and I don't know how to deal with it, so I'm just like leaving it alone, where my brother-in-law lives in a town on Long Island. He's married to one of my sisters, and he saw a huge neon blue, really, brilliant blue, very big orb go very slowly over his town. He was standing outside with his dog, and then all of a sudden take off and move at such a rate that he was fascinated. And he lives and works at airports all his life, so he knows what he's looking at. And he just told it to me following week, I got like three or four orb reports. In fact, I sent you, I think, one and put them up on my thing that people on Long Island were seeing all these orbs. And then I got last, maybe 2 weeks ago now, this happened. I got one of my relatives called up and said they also live in the same area where my brother-in-law saw his blue orb. And he said, look at this, something going on in town. A bunch of people watched these orbs come out over the coast, meaning coming in from the ocean, and fly over, and they all are living in these coastal villages along Long Island, fly over the area and then take off. And hundreds saw them. Nobody wants to, you know, own up to it. But there's a problem. One man claims he was in his house and an alien came in, and it had a face that looked like it was melted wax. It had on a blue suit and black, like, army boots. And it scared him, and he started screaming and ran away and got men in the neighborhood, and they did call the police. And when they went in, of course, there was no one there. But the man was so distraught that he had to be hospitalized. So I said, well, what do you want me to do? You want me to write this up, and can I at least say what town it was in? And I got total, absolutely, like, we'll sue you. You're going to go to hell and everything else. No, we're just telling you because we want you to know. So I said, okay, now I know. Well, what do you do when you get a situation like that dropped in your lap and you cannot write about it with any kind of degree of sounding, because you can't use places or, you know, descriptions, or you just
– yeah.
That data is just lost.
I haven't had that much trouble with you know, like a lot of my articles that I post on my website, you know, a lot of the witnesses say that I can use their initials or something like that. I haven't had too many people give me a hard time about that, but I've just learned that there's certain situations, especially abduction cases, I like to kind of keep it all secret until we've totally investigated, and then we can kind of go from there and see if the witness would be willing to, have their account published. But a lot of times abductions, you know, turns out to be a very long story. Nine times out of 10, it seems to me that a lot of the abductions go back, you know, all the way back to their childhood, and involves a lot of family members. And you can probably write a book alone on someone's abduction experience that they've had. So it's very touchy. You know, you just have to play it by ear and try not to get yourself in any kind of trouble.
Yeah. Either of you hear anything else about someone seeing something in their home or face to face like that recently?
Nope, not recently. No.
I've seen a couple on the MUFON cases. I view all the MUFON cases that come over the board every day, and there seems to be a few of them in there where these creatures come into the house, and you really don't. It's a shame because automatically you're thinking that something is a hoax, but I've just found out to believe a witness, and I've learned that anything is possible. It really is. You just have to check it out and investigate it, and nine times out of ten, in my cases, it turns out to be a true story of, you know, or what the witness thinks is true. So it's you really can't judge a book by its cover sometimes.
Interesting. Do we want to go into, Chris, you got anything else you want to bounce in here before we go to the photos?
No, we can bounce. No, not now. I'm sure I'll think of something. You say things and it triggers.
Well, and that's good. That's what we want to have happen anyway. So it's a very fluid conversation, but we have 10 photos that Ken has selected for us tonight that he's going to go through. And photo number one is a photo of an alien craft over Argentina, February 10th, 2015, Mar del Plata, Argentina. and it's a photo of an alien craft. So this is kind of an interesting photo. It's
that blue too.
It's a blue streak, and it, yeah. What do you think we're seeing here, Ken, when we look at this?
Well, basically, the witness claims that it came out of the water, it floated over the water, and then it accelerated to changing direction. So, you know, sometimes reading some of these case files, you know automatically it's not a satellite if it's accelerating and changing direction. So that kind of rules out satellites. You know, looking at that photo, it's really kind of hard to say. As a matter of fact, I think I've seen a couple of these photos, this type of craft.
In that color, too. That's a common.
Up there near next to the ISS there, the International Space Station. I think NASA has a few copies of this exact craft or something that looks very much like it. That's a good shot. And you have to realize, too, that on these photos, what I do is I usually crop them. I usually enlarge them. So a lot of these photos are a lot further away than what it looks like. So, you know, you would look at this photo and say to yourself, you know, it looks like it's only a couple hundred feet in the sky. Well, you know, this photo, this object was much further than that. And like I said, I usually crop them and enlarge them to show you a good photo of the actual craft. But I don't know. You know, the witness statement, they were fishing and they all went fishing. And a lot of people saw this. A ton of people saw it and they were screaming and acting, you know, they were shouting UFO. And they were, the people were the witness said that they were like acting crazy. They were just so shocked by what they were looking at. And the way it took off, you know, she basically said it reminded her of the movie where the DeLorean took off in a lightning flash.
Back
there.
The
what was the name of that?
Oh, yeah.
Back to the Future, yeah.
The Future, yeah. She says that's what it looked like to her.
This is interesting. This is interesting.
They were all weirded out by the whole thing. Yeah, I had this article is on my website, worldufophotosandnews.org. You know, you can read the full account there if you like to. That's a pretty great photo, I think.
What's interesting about this is look at the dual plumes on this thing. I'm trying to figure out, are those lights and it's simply in motion? It's got this blue ring around it. So, I mean, it looks, you know, if you look at it and you go, well, it looks vertical. You know, I'm not sure what we're seeing there in terms of how fast it was moving and the velocity, but the fact that they snapped this at night, do we have any idea what kind of camera they used?
And you can see the solid part there, like an H, you know what I mean? Where and the rest of it looks lights, or is it just, that's it, it's a big H and the whole thing's lit up. It's hard to figure it out.
It's hard to say whether this thing was hovering at the time they took the photo or was it traveling and how fast was it traveling?
Yeah.
You know, of course, you know, at nighttime, it's very hard to get a good picture of anything moving across the sky without getting the lines and the blurs and everything else on it. But I'm kind of surprised this photo came out as good as it did at nighttime.
Yeah, it would be interesting to know what it was shot with. It's because it's actually a very good photograph, and we don't always get good quality from, you know, like consumer-level cameras, and what I'm assuming is maybe even a camera on a mobile phone, which are getting better all the time, too, by the way.
They have a lot of megapixels now on them. Phones are a lot better than the cameras you go out and buy at a single-lens reflex nowadays. So, yeah.
Yeah, this is phenomenally good picture. Any other questions or comments about photo number one?
No, let's go to number two. I got questions about this.
Oh boy, this will be a good one then.
Yeah.
Okay. Photo number two is actually more your archetypal UFO in terms of what we would. It's this is weird too. It's a disc, and it's got this huge glowing auric center to it. Pretty interesting.
Yeah, this is one of these 4th of July photos. They took this after the 4th of July there. This was in Dexter, Missouri, July 4th, 2015. Dexter, Missouri, which we get a lot of UFO reports out there, and she claims that she saw this flying saucer-like object in the night sky over her house. And of course, the only problem with the theory is that it was on the 4th of July, you know. But she's convinced her mother and her husband that they witnessed on the night of the 4th. They saw this thing, and it didn't resemble any fireworks they witnessed. And it was about 9:30. And my husband called me to come outside, you know, to see what was flying overhead. And they checked it out, thank God they got a pretty good shot of it. They took a few photos. Let me see here. Anita Barnes' phone, or cloudy and distant. One in particular stands out. So this is the one photo they were able to capture that looks pretty weird. You know, like I said before, that like this photo, this object was further up in the sky, and of course I enlarged it and you know brought it where you can appreciate it instead of having a dot on a picture, which a lot of these photos are. You know, we enhance them and enlarge them and kind of bring them in so you can see the actual object. But
you know what's interesting? This is really interesting because I'm looking at this on my computer and I can zoom in and zoom out on it. Zoomed out or even shrunk down, it's a very distinctive form here. We've got a yellow disc-like outer perimeter and then this glowing white center. Are very distinctive. This doesn't conform to anything we would traditionally see in terms of light. It's not a Chinese lantern. That's very clear. The shape of it is very much the classic UFO thing.
Wait a minute.
Yeah.
I hate to tell you this. I've seen this before.
You have?
Uh-huh. And I was in China. And it is a lantern. I've seen it before. And it's huge. And they are now purchasing them in this country. But they're very big. They are the size of they make them the size of like a one-car garage. Like an old-time one-car garage would be that size or a car.
Oh, wow.
And they make them better than this even. They look exactly like flying saucers. And that's their intention. That's why they do it. And they make other shapes and things too. But this was one that they were particularly fond of. And they loved sending it up because they caused all kinds of havoc and chaos and got all kinds of reports called in. But it is. And in fact, you can see underneath, if you look underneath the white part in the center, you're going to see the glow where I believe the fire was. And they go up, they go very high, they're extremely bright, and they will float with the airstream, and then they burn out. And when they start to burn out, they come apart and start to separate, which you can see on this one on the right-hand side. So I hate to be the debunker on this particular case.
I like it.
But I personally have seen them, and I was fascinated because they look just like a UFO in the sky and at the size of them. But the Chinese are weird people and they went to great lengths to produce these. And now I understand they are also selling them along with other things that they shouldn't be allowed to, shapes that are very, very big. And they are selling them now in the United States as well. But my feeling is that this is a huge Chinese lantern. And that they were hoaxed, and that's why
I'm going to have to research that and see if I can get an actual photo of you know what one of these Chinese lanterns look like.
But you can go on to their sites, which I don't know if you can even do in this country, and you go on to their lantern sites. They're lined all up, all the UFO lanterns. Now I don't know if you can do it here. You can do that in China, but I'm sure. If they're buying them here, you've got to be able to buy them somewhere. They're going to be listed
someplace. You're telling me these are really large. That was what was throwing me off. And I got to admit, looking at that thing, that glow and the outer aura to it was very compelling.
Yeah. and they have to use the thing like they do a hot balloon almost. The fire that they need, the amount of energy that they have to put into this thing to get it up there, I felt was very dangerous. Or watch them, you know, they're all running around yelling in Chinese. Firing this thing. I'm sorry,
over mountains where it's really
right,
burning up.
It was dangerous, and yeah. They did start fires with them. They have been known to fall on structures and set them on fire. They're not safe. The only place they're safe is if you set them out over the water. And then if it fell on a boat or something, it's not even safe because it's so big. But they didn't last as long as the regular lanterns can, which can go for miles. This thing burned out, you know, pretty quick, like, you know, half the time the regular ones do. But what they do with the lantern things and how big and brilliant they made them now, I feel like slapping them because it's really messing up this whole subject matter. And they're, you know, dumping it in there for that reason. And it's
I got a question. Her statement is, part of her statement is, it says here, at one point, two of them had come back towards my house. Okay, now that could be the wind blowing, that could be anything really blowing back towards the house. And then it says, then they disappeared. Okay, now that's kind of telling me if these were Chinese lanterns, then they just went out.
Yep.
But then it says, and then the single white light saucers just came out of nowhere for hours.
Well, I don't know unless, but if they had this, they were sending up all kinds of stuff. So, and the thing was, if they weren't maneuvering on their own intelligently in different directions, but all going like together, it would be a lantern, and they just go.
Yeah, that'd be the wind blowing around. Yeah. I'm wondering why she would say that these things were there for hours. Even an hour would be a very, very long time for a Chinese lantern to stay in the sky, I think. But that's very interesting. You may be right there, Chris. That's for
and
sure.
And they use a lot of fire. I don't know what they leave in it, but it's brilliant. I mean, you know, it's really lit up. It's not like a candle. Yeah. They've got some kind of thing burning in there. So. But that's interesting. That's cool. But that's my opinion of this one. I saw this exact thing. That's why I say it. Exact color.
Yeah, you may be right.
Yeah.
Well, but how awesome is this that we're sitting here doing this live? I mean, you didn't see these photos.
No.
These are pretty much unrehearsed first takes on our thoughts on these things. So now for the listeners and viewers out there, that's part of what this show is. It's very interactive.
And not everybody. I spent a lot of time in China, and I saw a lot of things, and this just happened to be one of them. I also saw them change the weather in Beijing. So, you know, I saw a lot of things there. Yeah.
So we can move this one as debunked.
Yeah.
That's funny.
Okay. We want to move to photo number three.
This is
extremely strange and interesting. Go
and
ahead
scary.
And give us the narrative on this one.
Yeah, this is only two photos of seems to be a half dozen, maybe nine photos out there that are showing different things. Now, these photos apparently were taken through a periscope of a submarine.
Oh.
And it says here the black and white images are believed to have been taken from the USS Trepang SSN 674 submarine as it traveled between Iceland and Norway's Jan Mayen Island in 1971, or evidence of secret U.S. craft or alien craft. A guy named Alex Mistretta, a paranormal investigator and author, investigated the image after they appeared in French paranormal magazine Top Secret, following an alleged leaked, according to the Black Vault. The original anonymous source claims that the one photos were taken from the United States submarine. Location, again, was between Greenland and Jan Mayen Island. I put a map there to kind of give you an idea as to where this sighting was. And It was the Black Vault that has verified all the points and original source has claimed, and although his investigation is ongoing, he was happy to see that many of the facts did pan out, which means if it is a hoax, whoever did it definitely thought it out beforehand. But yeah, there's a ton of photos out there right now, and I picked out the two best. And like I said, this was supposedly taken from the admiral on board was Dean Reynolds Sackett. Obviously, the next step is to try to locate this admiral, Dean Reynolds, if he exists. The submarine came upon the object by accident as they were in the region on a routine joint military and scientific expedition. Officer John Klika was the one who initially spotted the objects with his periscope. So, yeah, that's what you have there. It's, like I said, it's only two photos of a ton of them out there. It was about at least 8 or 9 photos, different photos of different things. And that's, I thought it looked pretty...
real.
Pretty real, you know.
Yeah.
I don't know
what's
if that's...
the thing about this one is, when you look at it, and did you say this was night? This was taken at night? Do we know that?
It doesn't say. It's really kind of hard to say when this was taken. It looks like not during the day, but I would think during the, maybe the sun going down.
I'm just looking at the tint. Obviously, this is done with photography. If you look at the grain of this thing, and I did a lot of photography back in the day with film, so I'm looking at it from the analytical side that... if you don't blow it up, if you just look at it on its surface, the tint and the grain are very consistent with certain types of black and white film that you would have seen. But it's also looks oddly enough like it might have been infrared, or at least a very high, what you call ISO setting. So that's kind of what I was looking at with my eye, was this is legitimately film as opposed to anything digital, and it doesn't look compromised in any way. It looks pretty legitimate.
Look at the sunshine or moonshine, whatever it is, on top of both of these objects, and then look at the water, the glistening from whatever light
it is. I'm thinking that sun, and that I'm looks... thinking that this being taken through a lens would change it too, plus the fact there's probably aging on the photographs themselves, and the type of film that they use would have probably been fairly large-grained, because that's consistent with high ISO film to use a larger grain. The film's very grainy on these, so it gives you kind of a sense. I'm sure somebody who's an expert in photographic forensics could probably even tell you within a range what kind of film it is based on the film grade.
Now, do you think these things were in the water with the sub and coming out of the water, or over the water watching the sub knowing it's under the water?
Boy, that's really close to the water, isn't it?
Yeah.
Well, there are a couple of additional photos that shows something coming out of the water or going into water. You really can't tell what it was doing. But, there was a photo of I don't know if it's this craft, but something very similar, half out of the water that's attached to these photos that this guy took, from the periscope.
Interesting. These are the rather unique photos.
Yeah.
Anything else anybody want to comment
on?
No,
I think these are good. I think these are real and very interesting. Now, what one are we doing?
We're doing number 4 now. This is.
Yeah.
I'm going to let Ken give us the narrative.
Yeah, I don't know what.
Yeah, let me take a look at the United Kingdom.
Yeah, this is
United Kingdom, the blue ball with the outside.
This is like one of them blue orbs that you were talking about.
Yes,
now I don't know if this is the bottom of a flying saucer or if this is just a blue orb there in the sky, but it's very pronounced now this was taken April 29th, 2015, so all of these photos so far, or a couple of them, they're pretty recent. And this was Charnham Park in England, United Kingdom. Newsbury Weekly News reader Vanessa Cole snapped this image and many more like it of an unidentified aerial phenomenon above her home in the Charnham Park vicinity. And she works a night shift, and she first saw the object several weeks ago and was amazed when it returned, not once but several times. On the latest occasion, she said, "I was so fascinated, I went and knocked from my neighbors. They couldn't believe that what they were seeing and got their cameras to take stills and video images. The strange thing is that it seems to change shape and sometimes is surrounded by green lights and sometimes blue. I first saw it out of my bedroom window." So she's, I'm glad they got a photo of this.
This is
like I said, this just kind of reminds me of a lot of these orbs photos that we've been getting. But there's just some strange things floating around in the sky out there. I know that.
This is what's been described to me over and over and over again, just like what we're looking at now, this blue thing, the blue orb with the different, And they constantly talk about the blue, how when you look at it, it's unlike other blues and that you can look into it. It doesn't repel your eye or make you, squint or anything, that it's just very unusual. And I guess it is. What can I say?
Yeah, it says here, part of it, it says here, since the story was published, in the Hungered Ford edition of this week's Newbury Weekly News, more residents have come forward to say that they have seen this mystery object too. One reader sent their own photograph of the mysterious phenomenon, but none could offer an explanation as to what they've seen. So it's still an unknown right now, I guess.
Yeah, these orbs are everywhere.
Yeah.
They seem to just be like watching the people or watching us or surveying us or something. And often you'll get reports of little orbs coming out of these things and taking off like little, going like looking in windows or whatever it is they go do, scooting around and gathering data and then coming back to them. They're very predominant lately and very odd.
They're almost kind of like a pod when you see them.
Yeah, yeah.
They're like a pod sending out like reconnaissance pods. Very strange.
You can't get a size because the distance, we have no reference. So we don't know if this thing is the size of a house or a skyscraper or a car. And the small ones coming out, the same thing. We can't judge it because in the night, at distance, it's just impossible to determine that.
Yeah. Yeah, because I've enlarged it and I zoomed in on it. So, this was higher up in the sky, that's for sure. I think a lot of these things are floating around up there, but people can't see them because they're so high up. But if you start taking photos with a good digital camera or even a camera attached to a telescope, you'd be very surprised at what you find up there.
I'm sorry, go ahead, Chris.
This also looks like it has that gaseous plasma type inside that people talk around. Yeah.
Yeah. I forgot what I was going to say.
I picked this up from a UFO casebook, Billy Booth. He's got an excellent website there,
casebook. Yeah.
Yep. Yeah. Check it out if you get a chance.
No, I love Billy.
We've had Billy on the show before. We probably need to get him back.
He's a good man. I like Billy.
He's an old buddy of mine, Billy. I like him a lot.
Photo number 5. You're going to have to
I can't make out this too well.
Yeah, apparently this was taken, this was right off the wing of his aircraft. He took the photo with his camera. I think he tells us what kind of camera it was, but basically his statement was this craft was over California, April 22nd, 2015, apparently in the Hayward, California area. He claims that he was on an IFR flight plan and in contact with the ATC the entire flight. I was about 60 to 70 miles east of Hayward, California at 10 o'clock and given at 10,000 feet and given permission to descend to 6,000 feet. And he noticed a greenish ball of light pop up from the layer that was at 6,000 feet. It seemed to be 1,000 yards away to my 11 o'clock. It rose to my altitude and stopped, and it appeared to be pacing me. 30 seconds later, a second one popped up from the cloud cover. It stopped next to the first one. Then the lights started to move up and down and left to right. Then 15 to 20 seconds later, they vanished, only to appear about 50 feet off the nose of the aircraft. They started the same movement for 30 seconds, and then a blink were gone. I then called ATC, that's air traffic control, and reported and asked for any other targets. I was told they were not seeing anything. Just as I stopped talking, I looked out to my left wing, and there is an object or craft on my right wing, right next to the wing, and to the right another. And they were not feet away, but inches. I had already turned off all interior lights and exterior to verify to myself I was not seeing any type of reflection. There were at least 4 to 6 of them, and I took 2.34 of high definition video and captured at least 30 frames of something I don't think I have ever seen before. This is not a hoax or in any way a joke. The object faced me, it stayed in my plain view, hovered over me while I was setting up for an approach to Hayward. And he claims that this camera was a basic Samsung S3 recording in high definition. And he talked to the FAA, and you know, he said the FAA spoke with him, but that's kind of where it all ended. But this is what he captured. It's really kind of hard to say what this thing is up there.
Is that one thing or separate?
I was going to ask the same thing.
Yeah.
It looks to me like there's a projectiles coming out of a single object, though. Some kind of external lights or fuselage or something on this. It's very interesting shape. But
I think it's one object myself.
Yeah.
With lights on it, but the shape of this object is, you kind of wish you'd you can see the whole object. I think this is only a part of what he actually saw myself.
Man, yeah. I wish I could see that. I wish we could see the high-def video. I mean, that would be real.
Yeah, that's something I really should be looking into, seeing if I can. I normally don't deal in videos. 99% of the time, you really can't make out what they shot. It's I'm standard. I stick with the photos, but every once in a while, you can get a pretty incredible video that's been coming out on YouTube, and some UFO organizations have some pretty incredible videos that's coming out.
They were playing with him or deciding whether to take him. That's my opinion of this. I would really like to know more about this. I think he had a big close call. That's for sure.
He said that the objects were quiet and they did not produce any upsetting wake. And believe me, they passed feet in front of me multiple times at speeds I would guess would be over 200 to 2,000 knots.
Wow.
Yeah, so that's kind of weird right there. Yeah.
But that green glow, I always wonder about these colors that we're seeing, especially when they're shot against the night sky, because I've seen that color before. This is, that color is actually a big tell to me.
Yeah. Yep. Yeah. It's not. Their colors are different. Definitely that they use on their crafts. Yeah. This is an interesting shot, and people would look at this and not find it interesting, knowing that this was inches away from some poor guy trying to land his plane. Is interesting.
Yeah.
Well, we know pilots. You know, and these guys are flying under duress a lot of times, but. They're some of our best witnesses, so whenever we get something from somebody that's up in the air, I'm always very interested in knowing what their observations are and what the fact that he's telling you there was no waking from what would be propulsion turbulence in the airstream says that, you know, moving at those speeds, this thing isn't behaving like a normal craft in that sense, to be that close. I mean, that's one of the reasons why planes are not allowed to go within close proximity. Is that correct, Ken? It's just like a boat when you talk about.
That's right.
Yeah,
you're right.
I have four friends, close friends that, you know, I grew up or know all my life that became pilots. And do you know that every single one of them has, like, just said to me, oh, yeah, of course, we all have seen them, and then would tell me their stories of what they've seen. So it seems to be, I think, many, many pilots see things that they know are not other Earth-like, you know, Earth crap from the Earth.
They're probably the most credible witnesses, especially there's a ton of cases out there that's been publicized for even our military pilots are starting to come out of the closet and you know, say that they've kept pace with UFOs up in the sky. Even George Fowler, the guy I worked for, he has a pretty couple interesting stories about UFOs in the sky that they were chasing over England. So it's I think they're probably one of the most credible witnesses out there as it would be a pilot.
Yeah. My one friend, he unfortunately passed away, and his father was the president of a college here on Long Island, so he's not going to come back and make up these things. And he would tell you, if you asked him, he wasn't shy about it. He was a fighter pilot in Vietnam, and he'd had many, many flights where he went in and bombed. And I asked him, I said, did you ever see anything, George? And I asked him. He says, what do you mean, ever? He said, just about every time. It's, let me think. Let me answer it this way. How many times did I do a bombing mission where they weren't accompanying us?
Wow.
And I thought that was very telling. He said they were constantly there. He said they didn't interfere. They flew in with us. They watched what we did, and they flew out.
That was the Foo Fighters. Yeah.
Yep. So that's very interesting.
That's cool.
Okay, photo number 6. This is creepy. Go ahead and give us the 411 on this. This is Close Encounter and Photographic Evidence in the UK, 1987. Is that correct?
Yeah, that's alien photo I sent you. Let me see here. 1987, West Yorkshire, United Kingdom.
That one I don't have.
That was number 6. That was missing from the original batch. He resent this to me. So no, you don't have this.
Yeah. What does it look like? Describe it to us.
You're on Skype, right? I can send it to you over Skype.
Oh, okay.
So hang on there, and I'll do that.
Yeah.
Go ahead and run the narrative on this while I send Chris this this photo. Ken? Did we lose him?
I guess so.
Okay. We have to get him back.
Oh, well, I'm sorry, Randy. I must have hit a button or something. We just got cut off, I guess.
Well, anything could have happened. Gremlins in the system. Who knows? The good news is...
We're all back.
I wield a very, very sharp knife when I do video editing and audio editing, so it's not a problem.
Good. So, now, where were we?
Okay, photo number 6. I got distracted, so I didn't get around to sending this to Chris over the Skype thing. So, but you can go ahead and start. I want Chris to see this because this is spectacularly creepy.
Oh, my God.
Yeah, it is pretty, pretty incredible. Basically, the story goes, as the sun sets on Ilkley Moor and casts a shadow over the landmarked double stones above Silsden, it's easy to see why the area is awash with stories of the mystical and supernatural. Back in 1987, the West Yorkshire Moorlands made national news when a retired policeman claimed to have seen and photographed an alien rushing up the hill towards him. For a while, Philip Spencer was in much demand, with ufologists keen to speak to him about his apparent brush with the alien life form. Spencer was a more reliable witness than most. He had, he said, been walking across the moor to his father-in-law's home when the incident occurred. A keen amateur photographer had taken his camera in the hope of catching some images of the early morning light. Unfortunately, a low fog had descended on the moors, and he had resigned himself to being disappointed. However, as he used a compass to navigate through the fog, Spencer came across a strange-looking being. Immediately, he took out his camera, snapped a couple of pictures, and as he did, he claimed he had caught a glimpse of a craft with a domed roof rising into the sky. There was more. Believing the incident had lasted no more than a couple of minutes, Spencer continued his walk. However, when he reached his destination, he found the village clock an hour ahead of time, and those who believe in UFOs were convinced that all the evidence pointed to an alien abduction. More evidence came with the photographs Spencer took. Although slightly blurred, they appeared to show a four-foot alien creature. So that's the story about Mr. Philip Spencer. They're thinking that there was possibly an alien abduction involved, and I'm sure there's more to this story. But I'm into the photographs, so I thought that was a very interesting photograph that he took.
I guess did you mention there in the narrative, and I may have just missed it? Did he feel like he had missing time or anything like that?
Yeah, there was an hour. The village clock was an hour ahead of time, so he basically feels he lost an hour somewhere, it's kind of scary.
I would love
nine
to
times
see this.
Out of ten, that's that probably usually means an alien abduction, I'm sure.
Yeah, Chris, were you able to get that photo?
No, okay. I'm looking at the mail too.
Go back to the Dropbox that you were looking at photos at. I just uploaded it there.
Okay.
So you should have 06.
Okay. Okay, what did I do with everything?
She sounds like me.
It's just almost like sitting around a digital coffee table, isn't it?
Yeah.
Yeah, here it is. I saved it. I had to save it myself. Yeah, that's just...
So... This photograph, the one to the left, when we upload this up a little bit, you have an original, then it's a little hard to read, what level adjusted, and then color something.
Yeah, they colored portions of... based on suggestion, I think it says. I'm not really sure what that means.
Yeah.
It looks like it has something in its left hand. I'm sure his arms aren't that long. His right arm looks to be a normal size for an alien, I guess. But there's something in his left hand, and it seems like he's either leaning on a rock.
I thought that too. And I'm wondering, is there any report of the estimated size of this being?
Not that I know of. Like I said, there's probably a lot more to this story. That's why...
Well, what's interesting to me is the size of it, just the proportions, head to torso to leg length. You know, we've heard these stories for years.
Oh, my God.
Of these creatures of folklore, gnomes, elves, fae, or the fairies, as they're called... And this actually looks stunningly like possibly a fae. But the creature itself looks small or diminutive, I will say, even just based on the proportions of the body. And the face itself looks extremely gnome-like. When I looked at this, my first take on this was, holy crap, that's a gnome.
Wait, what year was this? I'm sorry, what year was this?
Let me see. That was 87. Let me just double check here. 87, West Yorkshire. Yeah, the moors. That's where he took it.
I've also seen something very, very similar to this in the very early 90s. It was taken in the Canadian wilderness, and there was a creature that looked dead ringer to this, holding what looked like a weapon behind a tree. And I got to tell you, it was a dead ringer to this one. That's very interesting.
Yeah. Now, are you talking about the one from Alaska? I think there was one in Alaska. Yeah.
No, this was in the middle of Canada in total wilderness. Guy owned a big ranch up there. Yeah. And this big light thing came down and landed in one of his fields. And he went out, and it frightened him, and he took a picture of it. And when he went home, or took two pictures of it, he took the pictures, and when they enlarged it, they saw one of these things standing in the field, like half behind, mostly out in the open, but a little bit behind a tree. And in its hand, like this has, in its right hand, it had what he thought was a weapon holding in his hand, which might be what this is.
Yeah.
And it, I'm telling you, Randy, it looked just like this. In fact, I might somewhere still have that picture. I don't know.
This is a marvelous picture.
Yeah. I would say that this thing is real. The shadowing and everything. I think that this was something standing there.
Yeah, and the viewers out there, you know, if you have similar pictures or similar experiences, I'd be interested in hearing anybody's anecdotal evidence on this one. This is beyond interesting.
Yeah, just Google Alien 1987, West Yorkshire. I'm sure a few things should pop up. It's not on Google if it doesn't exist.
This is a wow picture.
Yeah, that's another UFO casebook.
Yeah, that's incredible.
That's pretty awesome.
Yeah.
Okay, let's see. We'll move on here. Keep moving on to photo number 7. Oh, this is interesting. And this is, go ahead and give us a description of this. Astronomer's amazing alien UFO craft captured on film.
Yeah. We've found it. As a matter of fact, one of my biggest cases I had with MUFON, New Jersey, was out of Alloway Township, New Jersey, and this guy was an amateur astronomer, and he had two of the most incredible sightings as a triangle flying over his house, and then he took some photos. Probably, I think one of the best nighttime photos in the world. Of a craft that he took a very clear photos of, and he was also an amateur astronomer. And I know these guys are coming across all kind of things up there in the sky. But this was out of a UFO casebook. Briefly, it says here, a Hastings man has sought the opinion of the observer's resident UFO expert after capturing an unexplained phenomenon on camera. Alan Harding visited our Woods House office today to ask Malcolm Robinson, who took over a series of pictures captured on his camera, which appeared to show a UFO. So apparently this Malcolm Robinson is the one who took the photos on April 21st of, I believe, this year. He captured the pictures while photographing the moons of Jupiter. Mr. Harding set up his camera outside his Harold Roadhouse to capture the alignment of the moons of Jupiter, the solar eclipse, on March 18th. However, when he viewed the images, he spotted a bright object which appeared to move around the sky over the space of 12 minutes. I didn't notice it until I emphasized the image. Otherwise, I would have stayed up all night, he says. After taking the images to several observatories, he decided to seek the advice of Mr. Robinson, although it was selling initial, selling adverts for the Observer series. Mr. Robinson is a leading expert on UFO and has just finished filming for a new Channel 5 documentary. Speaking about Mr. Harding's images, he said, my initial was that it may be lens flare. Due to the nature of a bright planet, sometimes there is flare to the left or to the right. However, the gentleman assured me that it was not that, and it was the images turned out to be easily explainable. The remaining 5%, 3% is military or other advanced technology, and 1% is a new atmospheric phenomenon. This 1% that remains is the fly in the ointment. That is what keeps scientists and ufologists a world over interested in the subject, he said. It's great to have a local man coming up, not with just a strange story, but some real great images, Mr. Harding said. I take millions of images. I'm a technological person, and I know all the issues you get with lens flares. I have got no explanation for it. So apparently this man, Mr. Robinson, he can't explain it. You know, he's not saying it's lens flare or anything. It's just, it's a UFO, I guess. is what he's saying.
Well, my God, how big is that thing? I mean, what are we seeing in the lower, to my perspective right now, lower left-hand corner of that photograph?
All the white lights, yeah.
Yeah, some kind of star, a distant star.
So if he was photographing Jupiter, and he's doing this from a terrestrial telescope, at that distance, given the vagaries of parallax and magnification, how big is this thing? This looks like a mothership. My God, it looks like the size of a small planet from what
we're... Yeah, it looks very big.
It's huge.
And you know, it's funny, it's the same color as that red, that blue orb we were looking at, including the middle of it and the outer edge of it. It's almost like, you know, a continuation of that orb, or the orb was possibly connected with this somehow.
I always wonder about the color shifts you get when you're photographing through a telescope. This is where I don't know a lot, but I'd be interested to know. You know, we're looking at this thing at pretty high magnification, but if you even zoom this thing down on the screen, it's still a profoundly big object relative to what it looks like he's shooting here.
Yeah.
You know, how could you even miss this? This is phenomenal.
Well, that thing's the size of a planet, I would think.
Oh, my God, it's huge. That's a mothership, man.
I don't know. Apparently, he didn't know either. You know, a lot of these guys, you know how they are. The scientists, if they can't see it, taste it, smell it, hear it, or touch it, it doesn't exist. And you know, when they admit that they don't know what it is, then I thought it was a very interesting photo myself.
You know, that's one thing we never talk about. What if there is the possibility that other civilizations have come and gone from where they originated and are now out there floating around in space on ships that are the size of a planet and actually living and existing on these huge, huge crafts? I mean, that's not impossible. Anything's possible.
Anything's possible. That you're right there. That reminds me of the Death Star there on the that one. What show am I thinking of? That big planet, the Death Star, that everybody was living on. That could be. It could be. Anything's possible. It could be the size of the moon or the Earth,
it could be
floating around in space. Yeah,
right. With the cities on it and farms and, you know, oceans, everything. It just could be made. And that's why it can travel freely. Oh, wow. It's amazing.
This statement by the witness was a little confusing to me. But Mr. Harding, he's the one who took the photos. And, of course, Mr. Robinson, he's the leading expert on UFOs. And just finished filming a new Channel 5 documentary. Yeah, he's the one who can't explain it. Well, no one can explain it at this point. So as of right now, it's considered a UFO.
But again, you know, we're sitting around the table here, the digital table, just looking at these photographs and assessing them. Some are compelling. One has been debunked by Chris.
Mm-hmm.
But this is, you know, again, a chance to kind of forensically go through the evidence and show people what people like you see as you're doing your research. Because, I mean, Ken, you look at these photographs all the time.
Yeah.
I go on the internet every once in a while. I sift through things, but I'm not really a UFO researcher in that respect. So this is just kind of fun. And it gives the listeners and the viewers a chance. Well, if you're just a listener, you're not going to get this. But the viewer a chance to kind of see some selected cases in a broad cross-section of the type of photographic evidence that is out there.
Yeah.
Yeah. And what I try to do, I try to keep the best photos. You know, you'd be surprised at the thousands upon thousands of photos that I've tried to hand that... you know, they just look like dots on a picture, and who knows what it is. But, you know, I try to get something that looks like the real deal. And hopefully there are some real alien crafts on my photo collections. And I tell people I get 8,000 photos, and then if one of these one of these photos is a real alien craft, and you know, to me, it was all worth it.
Absolutely. Now the next one, Randy, talking about looks like the real deal.
Yeah.
This one fascinates me. Number 8.
Yeah, alien craft discovered on Mars. Mars anomaly hunters. Go ahead, Ken. Give us the backstory on this.
Yeah, let me bring that up here. Oh yeah, this is pretty recent. There's quite a few photos, and I dug out one of the best ones I could. It's people like myself. They start to investigate these NASA websites and moon websites, high def, try to get hold of the high def photos, which is easier said than done, because I think NASA must have 100 different websites, and trying to find that right website with the high definition photos, that's the challenge. But every once in a while you get lucky and you fall upon a website that does have these photos. But this one here says the Mars anomaly hunters have discovered a giant UFO flying saucer abandoned on rugged Mars terrain. The latest UFO find on a red planet was reported on March 27th by two YouTube anomaly hunters. Mars Moon Space Photo Zoom Club is what they're called, MMSPZC. I'll call them the Moon Club. So, according to the Moon Club, the UFO flying saucers was discovered in images of the Martian region of the Aram Chaos, CHAOS, 2.6 degrees north, 21.5 degrees west. I'm kind of glad they gave us some coordinates here. Near the valley, the canyon Vals Marinis and Aris Valis. The images were captured by NASA's Mars Orbiter camera. And this Moon Club here points out that, contrary to what some may think, the structure is not part of the natural Martian terrain, but an object or artificial construction probably abandoned on the surface after it developed a fault and crashed. UFO sighting daily, Scott Waring notes, close examination of the object suggests a metallic cluster that is in a sharp contrast with the Martian soil in which it appears partially embedded. The saucer also has a direct curved or singular shape with sharp edges indicate of artificial construction. So that's what they found. I think it's a pretty remarkable photo they have here. And as Chris knows, I have a ton of Martian discoveries and discoveries on the moon, Mars, things that I found that, you know, it's very easy to find. Every time I go to Google Earth and go to the moon or Mars portion of Google Earth, I am always finding something that's very strange, you know, and I really can't explain, you know, what you find most of the time. But this was a pretty incredible photo.
I just saw a photograph on Facebook that somebody put up. And again, I have a lot of my paranormal and UFO contacts on Facebook, so I tend to watch that, of a woman standing on a rock on Mars.
I saw that.
Oh, yeah, I saw that.
Now, you know, I have to tell you something. These photographs are pretty compelling when you stop to think that they're putting all these photographs up, and a lot of them are going up in rapid succession. And every once in a while, you catch a form or something like this. This particular object is very metallic looking, in complete contrast to the rest of the surface there, which is that surface of Mars there is really creepy. It's like, wow, it's like roots. It's like almost like a root structure to a giant tree hanging out there. And then there's this metallic object sitting there. So it's in sharp contrast. But I think I told you before, Ken, about Andrew Basiago, who's pretty well known on the internet, who was part of a government project called Pegasus when he was a child. And he's going back and going through the Mars Explorer photographs and found different life forms on the face of Mars as well.
Yeah.
What about, see how this is obviously metallic or something other than the rest of the material around it, and it looks actually built. What about if this is not a flying saucer that's crashed.
Some kind of structure.
But a structure and an opening that
yes,
they either fly
overlooking
into
a valley or something, possibly.
Or the entrance to the interior. That's what it kind of could be, too. Because,
yeah,
you know, where I could see almost things entering and exiting this. And this is an entrance, which I think a lot of the things that we see on Mars, in my mind, could be. And I think the people that we see topside or the things we see topside are actually probably living in the interior of this planet.
Yeah.
That once may have been thriving. It may be where we all came from. But this, to me, could also be an entrance, you know, and an exit. It could be a portal into where they're actually living.
That's
and the
possible.
Strange structure on top, all this, like, root material may actually be the top of, you know, a city, a dome top material of a city or something. But if it's not a craft, it could be an entrance.
That's a good thought. Yeah, I didn't think of that. I thought, of course, automatically, I think a flying saucer myself. But no, you could be right, Chris.
Yeah. Did we lose Randy?
Nope, I'm here.
Oh, okay.
I muted up for a minute because I had a plane coming over.
Oh. As long as he wasn't trying to land in this hole, we're good.
Yeah, we're fine. Okay, so number nine.
We are nine?
Number nine.
Yeah, okay. Barkwell, England.
Yeah, this is interesting. This one I think we need the backstory on. This is pretty interesting.
Yeah, you would automatically think maybe lights in the sky, you know, how they're opening up a shopping center or something where they have these big lights in the sky. But apparently that wasn't the case. This was recent February 3rd of 2015, Leicestershire, England, I guess I that's pronounced it. The two orb-like unidentified objects were captured floating in the sky above Barwell. A 41-year-old woman spotted two balls of light, a bright white light, after strange noises woke her at 4:50 a.m. on February the 3rd, reports the Hinkley Times. She thought it was coming from downstairs, so she got out of bed and went to see what it was. After finding nothing, the woman went to make her way back to bed when she suddenly spotted the two lights out her window. Are these orbs of lights, of light UFOs? Joanne Kavanen, who is investigating the incident on behalf of MUFON, the Leicestershire UFO Investigation Network, said it was a clear night and there was no clouds in the sky. The lights kept merging into one and moved side to side. She said she watched them for about a minute and a half and got 20 seconds of video on her phone. Then they shot off at a speed together and merged into one again. It's quite an interesting case. Hinkley Times, paranormal, a 41-year-old woman from Earl Shilton spotted the two balls of lights while white light in the early morning of February 3rd of this year. Hinkley residents may have to remain vigilant. Joanne, who had experienced strange unexplained incidents herself, said the organization has tried to figure out what may have caused the lights. She said, well, we don't have a clue at the minute. We're trying to rule out whether it was an aircraft. We don't know it. It wasn't anything to do with a police helicopter, and we are still waiting to hear from the air ambulance. So then they were moving and shot off within seconds. There was not any action of a helicopter or a plane. A lot of incidents can be linked to Chinese lanterns or drones, but I don't believe the orbs moved in that way. So apparently they're still investigating this one here in England. So it was a very interesting, I thought.
Yeah, and they do not look like Chinese lanterns. They
no.
don't have that. But you know what's interesting about this picture? Look at the light. It's the white light that everybody tells you about, plus
yeah.
the orange light that everybody talks about, and the blue.
And the blue.
It has all the strange different light combinations in these two lights, meaning that they could probably turn orange or blue or white again split second. And they also have that joining together and splitting apart ability that everybody talks to you about too.
They're all connected. Yeah, I never thought of that. That's a good idea.
Yeah, it's almost like an amoeba.
Yes, it's like a living thing, isn't it?
Which I suspect is what a lot of this is we're seeing. I mean, even the craft themselves have strong reasons to believe that a lot of the craft, if not all of them, are organic.
Yeah.
That they have a consciousness somehow. I mean, that's creepy and that's weird. That's just my take on it.
Or they now build with biological components.
Yeah.
Where the stuff is a machine, but it's biological, and that might be so they can survive better in it. We don't know.
Yeah, like a plasma type of a,
Well, even the reports that came out of Roswell, and I wish I could cite the text right now. It was stated that the beings that they took out of there, it looked like they were biologically connected to the craft themselves. And that seems to be a consistent report that people get who are on craft and are able to see what you would call the pilots or the human operators, that there is, in fact, some sort of telepathic biological connection to the craft themselves. And when you look at these two forms, it looks like they're either merging or splitting. There's just a very slight
connection
between them, because I've been zooming it in and shrinking it back up again to look at it. They're sharing some kind of auric field there, and it's almost like a plasma.
And what if they built machinery that is biological and can feed and uses its energy from space, either dark matter or just a chemical we're not even aware of? So if it's biological, the actual craft could use what's around it for energy to travel. I mean, things that we cannot even think up yet could be part of it.
Yeah.
And to be a creature that's in this, you would have to be part of that biological thing. So it could be all of these. This could be the pilots, the craft and everything, both machine and biological material, which is something, Randy and I, you fear terribly about happening to the human race, that we would become just this.
Well, I think there's a forerunner for this. Go and read the narrative in the book of Ezekiel in the Bible about the wheels. And these wheels, and it's in the book of Revelation too. Look, these are ancient books. Even if you're not religious, you read these things and you go, what the hell are they talking about there? And you talk about the wheel and the wheel and the faces.
Yeah.
And the light and the lights. Yeah.
And you go, you know, it's entirely possible that what we're dealing with is phenomena that's so far beyond our comprehension, because we live in a three-dimensional space that doesn't really include this type of phenomena until it seems now. Now it seems, and again, we go back, the veil's being rendered, and we're starting to get glimpses into
things that maybe were always there.
That were always there, and things that we've tried to explain through our limited knowledge of physics and science, that maybe we have to explain phenomenologically from the standpoint of something that's a little bit more spiritual.
Yeah.
Well, you know my opinion of the science that we have today and using them, like taking a physicist and putting him on and having him try to explain to us all about science and space travel. My opinion of them is this is what you do with everything they tell you. Ignore it.
Yeah.
Because they have no idea what they're talking about. They only can judge on the science of man on Earth at this point in time, and we are so primitive and so, you know, far from understanding things, that what they say is immaterial. It's not correct. Next year it'll be wrong, and that yet they're very, very insistent and arrogant about it. So, you know, my theory is no, they have no idea what's going on there, because we're stuck here in a planet where we can't stop killing ourselves and can barely get off it.
Yeah.
And we're making decisions and statements about beings that can transverse the whole entire universe, if not dimensions, and figure it all out. So talking to a scientist who's telling us we can't go to another solar system because we don't have the energy source. You mean you don't have the energy source that you can think up on the Earth? it doesn't mean that there isn't multiple energy sources that you can't even comprehend yet, you know? I said, don't even listen to them. Just leave your mind open to, you know, this is happening. So you know that these things exist and that we are just ignorant of it at this point. But this here is a perfect example of what every people tell you. Every color that's reported to you is in these two orbs right here.
No, that's right.
I mean, I can just picture it turning orange, then turning blue, then turning back white.
Pulsing. Yeah.
Right. Pulsing, then going together and taking off. I believe it completely. I think these people should be very careful and stay away from these things in wherever it is that they're seeing them. Bartwell.
Okay, sports fans. Final round for tonight is photo number 10. And that is February 21st, 2015. Lake Winnipeg, Canada. Mysterious lights were seen over... Go ahead and give us the narrative on this. Did I get the right slide there?
I don't have a 10 either.
You don't have
Lucky
10
me.
Either?
No.
Okay.
Well, yeah, this is a MUFON case file. Yeah.
Okay.
Yeah, it says here mysterious lights were seen over Jackhead Reservation in Manitoba, Canada last week. He follows a suspected UFO crash into Lake Winnipeg as military forces allegedly spotted on snowmobiles pulling a massive disc out of the lake.
Oh,
but in
I
response
see it.
To reports about the UFO crash and recovery, Canadian forces said it was merely a military training exercise. Seriously? On Wednesday night, February 18th, reports started to make rounds on social media about the lights over Lake Winnipeg. According to the Facebook post by Brent Mancheese, there were reports about the UFO crash on the Jackhead Reserve in Manitoba, Canada. Allegedly, vehicles of the Canadian military were lined up on the North Shore. Taking pictures in the scene were strictly prohibited, and the Army even issued a threat to anyone who tried to do so. Lots of eyewitnesses were in the area. These witnesses apparently saw a round object being hauled across the lake and pulled out by snowmobiles. A fisherman reported the incident, but Mancheese wondered why the authorities did not let the media know if it was a plane crash. In another report, bad things happened to one witness with a camera. It said that a disc-shaped craft was spotted diving into the frozen lake. At least one witness managed to get a photo of the craft. Unfortunately, that person has since been detained by the Canadian military. So, looks like a cover-up already. They're trying to cover this thing up here, but that's the photo. It's the photo we have, and it's supposedly the real deal. So, that was pretty interesting.
Yeah. I'd love to see that thing pulled out of the water and see exactly what they got there.
Yeah, I should have sent that to you in the email, Chris.
Yeah, I did. I've got it. I'm looking at it.
Oh, you are? Okay.
Yeah, yeah.
Yeah, that was, that's apparently one of the better photos that they got of this thing. So, this is a MUFON case file. So, maybe I can find out a little bit more information about this. And maybe next time I talk to you guys, I can give you some updates as to, what happened to on a few of these cases here.
Do we know if that's in the water or is that embedded in ice or what are we looking at there?
It looks like it's embedded into the ice of the lake.
It looks like to me, too. Yeah. It's a little hard to see, but I'm blowing it up pretty high here. And what I'm seeing is, on one hand, it almost looks like displacement of water, but it couldn't be sitting there that long. It looks like it's in probably ice.
Can you blow it off to see what that lighter piece that, like, ribbon thing is that's laying on it? Randy, can you get
the resolution breaks down on the digital at that point. It pixelates once you get to a certain magnification. There's something circular in the center of that thing, though.
Really?
Yeah, this is not this. And the nice thing about this picture, here's what I really like. We have people in the foreground.
Right.
So we have a relative sense of size of this thing. I mean, we can assume that that's probably a third the diameter that's sitting out there, maybe a quarter. If you look at the size of that thing, it gives us some sense of size relative to the figures in the foreground. So this is actually a pretty extraordinary picture from that standpoint.
I'm basically thinking, you know, like I'd be standing on the hill looking down at this thing. It might be the size of a football field, you know, maybe 300 feet across, something like that.
Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm. Yeah.
How would you like to be one of these poor guys looking at this thing? You don't know what it is in the ice and being told, go out there and hook up some ropes. We're going to pull that out. Yeah. Oh, my God.
Get the wrecker truck out there. Let's see if we can pull this down. But that thing is heavy.
Go see if that burns you up when you get close.
like my favorite movie, The Thing. That's just one of the best shows ever. With Kurt Russell, I think, was in the first one, and well, no, he was in the second one. Then they had the third one. Just incredible movies. They're my favorite movies.
Well, this is an extremely good batch of photos, Ken, that you sent off tonight. Each one of them has a story. Even the debunked one tonight is interesting because it's kind of a lesson in, again, doing a little bit of forensics on the photography that we'll see. And, you know, Chris is brutally honest when she evaluates things. She's done this for, as you have too.
Yeah.
You've both done it for so long that you have a reservoir of experience that lets you kind of deconstruct things on the fly, which is why these types of shows are so interesting.
Oh, yeah.
Yeah, I think so. And I've been fortunate in my life. I've been to a lot of places and I've seen a lot of things. And when anything has to do with these subjects, because of my own personal experience, I'm very interested in. You pay careful attention and you do quickly pick up things that I think wouldn't even occur to other people. You know what I mean? Like colors or even sounds or smells or things like that. And
oh, yeah, that's right.
A thing I want to add about the orbs, just like the ones we were just looking at, is that when people tell me they had a UFO sighting of some type, I listen and, you know, I'm great and they're all excited and everything. When it comes to the big orbs, the craft size orbs, where they tell you that this thing was enormous, I always tell them, or even if it's just big and it's over them, not to think it's a wonderful thing and try to offer yourself up, which people have a tendency to do. They'll stand still, stop, and stare at it, which gives this thing an opportunity to say, do I want to snatch them? Do I want to leave them alone? Do I want to mess with these people? Too many people have been hurt by orbs or interfered with. I'm going to put it nicely. I think they have to be very careful of the orbs. I don't think they are, a gentle type of a craft. I think if it gets the opportunity, it'll mess with you or take you or try to hurt you or even burn you. So I think that people need to be very careful of them. It's like the new bad kid in town, and I'm not sure what it is, you know.
Well, you're absolutely right, Chris. That's for sure. I'd be very wary of them. Stay away from them.
Yep. And I've had a very bad situation with them. My father had a terrible situation with an orb. And I had people on Long Island tell me stories that just frightened me to death. And the two worst ones was a bunch of guys were in a volunteer firehouse meeting, all young fellas. And they came out and they went and parked in the parking lot where they parked their cars, which was a little isolated. And a very huge orb came and none of them knew anything about any kind of UFO situation, or they weren't into it at all. And this thing floated over them and just hovered over these nine guys. And the thing then went up and circled them around this parking lot, which was tree-lined, and circled around trying to decide what it was going to do to them. I mean, I had no – and they knew it. They said they knew that this thing was deciding whether to take them, and there was nine of them, or just pass it up. And it came back over them, and they didn't try to run. They stood all together in a tight pack, and the thing hovered over them for maybe 20 seconds, they said, and then just shot straight up in the air and was gone. And they all ran to their cars and left and were very terrified. And I knew that just by them telling me that story, that they were in trouble that night. And just for some reason, it didn't. Maybe it was too many of them. Nine was too many. They couldn't handle it. And then a family, and I always tell this story because I feel so sorry for them, decided to put an above-ground pool up in their house. They took and put it like – they had like an acre of property. So they decided to put it way at the end of their acre by the woods. And so they were far from the house. So when they got out of the pool to make it to the house, was a big run. And they're out there one summer's night in the pool, all flipping around. And I think he said there were five or six of them in the pool, family playing with the ball and having a good time. And all of a sudden, they see an orb come over them, too. And it stayed over them for a very long time, like 5 or 6 minutes, which is a very long time when you have an orb over your head.
Yeah, that is long.
And the thing was pretty high in the sky, but the same size of the pool, they felt. So it was much bigger than the pool because it was high. And it's lowered down, and it was very big. And the father said he didn't know whether to tell his family to jump out of the pool and run for the house or just stay there. So what he did was have them float quietly under the ladder like he had a deck built around it and hide under there and be very, very quiet and not move. And the thing watched them do it, but it decided, I guess it wasn't, they weren't interested in him, and it took off and left. And I think if he had told them to get out of that pool and run, that they would have lost a couple of family members. So I find these things extremely intimidating and dangerous. So, you know, if you see one, go get into safety, find safety, find
lights. The other way.
Get it, you know, don't go towards it. Don't do anything foolish.
Yeah, you're
so
right.
That's my only warning.
Okay. Well, anything else we want to bring up or talk about? Chris, you got any? You've got some interesting articles on your website right now, and maybe we can go there for a minute and take a look at what you're doing there.
Sure, I'd love to. I took, and this I watched years ago. It was like 2010, I think, and it stayed with me heavily since because I knew what I was looking at was probably alien. I can't think of it being anything else but maybe interdimensional, but I felt it was more alien. And it was a fact or faked episode of that TV show that aired years ago. And they would do this thing where they would take a video or pictures or somebody claiming something. And their thing was they would go out and see if they could duplicate it or replicate it to debunk it. And my case was always – well, even if you do that, how does it prove that the real incident didn't happen? I mean, people and state, what's the proper word for it when they recreate, you know, things that happen all the time. It's called Hollywood. And, you know, that's not proof that it didn't happen. It's just proof that you were able
to. That's one show that I cannot watch. I tried to watch it and you know, they – you know, with today's technology, you can basically recreate anything.
Right, and how does that prove that it didn't happen? The real thing didn't happen.
So they were a bunch of debunkers. That's what I think they were.
Right, and it didn't do anybody a service, but they had a few episodes they could not debunk, and they would deem as probably happening in real. Okay, fine. In this one episode, this man from Fresno, California, sent in what they call the Nightcrawler episode. And it was a home video camera, like his security camera, that I guess would kick on with motion. I'm not sure of it. But it was filming, and the people of it was across his front yard. These two things, I'm going to call them creatures, came down his street and cut across his front lawn that put on his cameras and caught it. And it looked like, I don't know what it looked like, it was a creature that I've never seen anything like it before. It looked like a clothespin, old-fashioned clothespin, or a ladder, or a stick-like man with a very awkward gait, and it maybe had on clothing or a cape or something, do this awkward walk, almost bug-like, across his lawn, followed by a second creature, and they walked across his lawn. Well, they went down there, this TV show, and they couldn't recreate it, and they couldn't figure it out. So they figured they're going to hang around at night and see if they can catch anything more. And lo and behold, they have night vision cameras or something. They hear something very unusual down by a water something, a lake or something, near this man's home. And they go down there and they hear very strange noises, and they have their night vision cameras and do pick up something walking around in the wooded area going into the lake. And they didn't know what it was, and I guess it scared them. So they did what you do when you finally get close to figuring something out in the paranormal world.
Sorry.
That's all right. They
just
packed
the video up accidentally.
They packed everything up and left. And that bothered me over the years. So finally, I wrote an article about it. I said, what is wrong with everybody? Here you found evidence and a video, and it's clearly something that is not of this earth. And what you do is go down, investigate it, find that the investigation has legs and there's more to it. So you pack up and leave, and nobody goes down and looks to see what happened or investigate it any further. So that's the paranormal way. Think about it. Oh, we're right on the scent of Bigfoot. We know he's, you know, a football away in those woods. So quick, everybody pack up everything and let's leave. That's what they do. They never follow through. There's no follow through. There's no – now, if that was me in that fact and fake case, it was so phenomenal. I would have called the university. I would have called any kind of scientific organization I could find. I would call, you know, many, many paranormal groups that maybe had some money and set up and really try to figure out what's crawling around that neighborhood. But that's not what happened. And all these years later, this case still – and one of the most phenomenal to me – just lays there. No one knows what was crawling around in that neighborhood that night.
My God, I just blew this picture up. Now I know what you were talking about when you told me they look like Gumby.
Yeah,
they look like or clothespins. This is phenomenal. It's weird and it's creepy and it's the wow.
Yeah, yep. It's one of the creepiest, strangest things I've ever seen. There's video of it all around, and you show it to people, and they just go slack-jawed and go, oh, yeah, don't know what that is. Well, that's never enough for me. You can't
Find out what it is.
That there's these unusual creatures that we don't know what doing walking across our front lawns in California. Don't know what it is isn't the answer I need, you know? So all these years, why that has not been solved makes me, you know, very annoyed with the paranormal. And these TV shows disgust me, because time after time, they'll go after a situation that is true and real. There's something to all this ghost phenomena that's going on. There's definitely something flying in our skies. There's aliens, there's creatures, there's shadow people that we don't know where they are. And we get close, we film it, we photograph it, we get just almost to it and say, oh, look at the time. Let's pack up and leave and get out of here because we're almost close to solving this. So, you know, that's to me.
We're dangerously close to success here.
Yeah, let's get the hell out of here.
Yeah, snatching failure from the jaws of success. Yeah, that's my favorite one.
Right. And that's the mantra of the paranormal. That's why these shows, they just disgust me.
Well, check out the Hangar 1 with MUFON. I'm very skeptic, and I hate most of these shows, but really, really surprised and impressed by the Hangar 1 show with MUFON. They got a lot of episodes now, and
and they're finally coming out and saying alien, and a lot of the cases on there are, you know, old military cases they had went on there about the Vietnam. And are you still there?
Yep,
yeah.
We're here.
Yeah, so it's check out that check out the Hangar One there. I think it's on the History Channel. It's very, very impressive. It really is.
And if you get a chance, go check out there up on my little blog there. Ken, go check out those aliens that I have the video up of. I have a bunch of video up of those.
I'm looking
calls.
At it right now.
Yeah.
And we're gonna put this into the video with the show. The viewers are seeing this right now. So.
Yeah.
This is marvelous stuff. You could actually probably do like a hip hop video with this. It's pretty interesting. We have about 2.5 minutes on the clock left, and I want to give you both a chance to identify yourselves on the internet, let people know where they can find you, and Chris, go first. And
all right, I'm easy. Chris Holly's Endless Journey with the Unknown. Put it in any search and it'll come up, and you hit it and it takes you to me. I'm also on Facebook under Chris Holly, and I filled up. I got 5,000 friends, so now I'm in Christine Holly, and that has about 3,000, I think, already or something like that. So if you want to befriend me, get in there.
Get in fast.
Yeah, and I do shows with Randy, so you can find me a lot on his sites as well.
Excellent. Ken, go ahead and tell people about, you have two sites, and they have similar titles, but they're kind of different sites, so tell us about that as well.
Yeah, my main site is worldufophotos.org. I have over 9,000 photos, a lot of great things on there, strange things about Mars, the moon. You just have to check it out. It'll take you a couple days to get through it. My other website is worldufophotosandnews.org. I publish an article every day, and one of the best articles out there, I usually put it on my website. So check that out. I'm the chief investigator for MUFON in New Jersey and also the state director for MUFON in Vermont and Rhode Island. So check me out on Facebook, and it was a pleasure talking to you guys.
This is fun. This is great. We can't wait another couple of years to do this, so we got to get back and do it again real soon. So, Ken, thanks for coming on. My guest, Ken Pfeifer, along with co-host Chris Holly. This is Off Planet TV, Off Planet Radio. Website is offplanetradio.com. We'll be back with another show very soon. The truth is out there. It's inside you. Keep looking for it and keep looking up.